Good morning, wherever you may be, around the globe, in the chat room, wherever you are. This broadcast is coming at you live from the capital city, Columbia, South Carolina, or in or around anyways. And again, I want to welcome you all. You know, I've been absent quite a few days the last week, and but, you know, I don't apologize for it. I have had an incredible time with two friends, two people who have been in our L&M chat room for a long time, Bruce and Adana Gossin. We have had an incredible time. Last night, early evening, we all went to Chili's, you know, to have a big dinner and such. And wow, we had a ball. We had a ball. The waiter was incredible. I put the picture up on the website. The waiter's in there with us. Just incredible. We just had a ball. Absolute ball. I mean, you know, this is what I love about late night in the Midlands. What I love about the L&M Radio Network and what we bring with our chat room is that we build, you know, Rascala talks about this often, but we build relationships. That's what that chat room does. There's a lot of real good people in our chat room, and I've got two of them here with me tonight. Even they're sitting out talking with Autumn as we speak, and I told them in between breaks I will try to get out there and say goodbyes, because I know tomorrow morning they'll be parting off. And so, you know, we're gonna miss them. We will miss them. It has been great having them there. It's nice to have a couple people that I can talk to about, you know, Rochester stories that I have, and they know exactly where I'm talking about. They know exactly what I'm talking about. Just, it's been really good. Folks, if you ever get an opportunity to meet two people as wonderful as Adana and Bruce, then you're doing things right in life. That's all I could say, because they are. They're just great people. We've had a ball, and I hate to see it end. I really do. You know, Adana got me this. She brought me this tennis racket Bug Zapper. I gotta say, it has got to be the greatest invention known to mankind. It has got to be. It is one of my favorite pieces of technology now, where I can go outside and the bugs cannot bug me anymore. Because all I have to, it's really, it's good. It's good for the cardiovascular. You know, you get a little one-man tennis game going on. All you got to do is go outside, turn the outside light on, and they'll come. And then it's zap, zap, pop, pop, boom. I'll tell you, a great invention, and I thank Adana for that little gift, because it is a prized possession of mine now. Looks just like a tennis racket. But when you press the button and you swat, you know, all you got to do is touch them. They just explode. Kaboom. I know it sounds cruel, right? But, hey, don't invade my airspace and you won't get zapped. But anyways, we've had a great week, folks. I'm here with you the rest of this week. I don't anticipate any absence from the show this week. And we've got a good one, I think, tonight. Tonight we will be speaking with Jackie Barrett. And Jackie Barrett is a psychic medium. She does quite a bit, as a matter of fact. More than just psychic medium. Seances, cleansings. I mean, she gets into a whole array of paranormal type activities, and I'm looking forward to talking with her tonight about that. And we'll probably talk for a little bit before we take any calls, but if you want to call in afterwards and maybe get a short reading or something on the air, I'm sure she might do that for you. The call-in number later is 803-317-2264. The website's latenightinthemidlands.com. Go on over, become a member, and be informed. Folks, all right, a little bit of news here. As many of you, I'm sure, know by now, a lot of talk about the gunman who opened fire with assault rifles at a Prophet Muhammad cartoon contest in Texas. Well, I'm going to tell you a little bit about that. And folks, I'm not taking any calls now. So please do not call in now. You're not going to get through and you're not getting put on hold. So when I announce we'll take phone calls, then we'll take them. Until then, you're just going to get knocked off the board here. So don't bother. One of the two gunmen who opened fire with assault rifles at a Prophet Muhammad cartoon contest in Texas has been identified, they say, by law enforcement officials as a man who was on the FBI's radar 4 years ago during a terrorism investigation. Of course, folks. See, I'm reading through this. I'll tell you, I've been pretty busy this week doing other things besides the show, to be honest with you. And so the news has been kind of creeped up on me. I mean, I've missed a lot this past week, but that's okay. Because I am now catching up on it all. So yeah, I'm sure the FBI did have their eye on him in more ways than one. Anyways, police spokesman Joe Harn said Monday that two men stopped at a parking lot entrance blocked by a police vehicle. They came out of their car armed with assault weapons and began firing on an off-duty Garland officer and an unarmed security guard who also were getting out of their vehicles to question the men. This is what this police spokesman Joe Harn says. The gunmen were wearing body armor, he said, and one shot the guard in the leg. The officer, of course, then returned fire, and, well, he John Wayne'd them both, folks. He took them both out, killing both of them. The guard was treated for his injury at the hospital, and then he was released. I want to remind you that the Jade Helm 15, you know, that is going on in Texas, and I personally think that there's some kind of connection here. Between these military exercises that they're doing and what you had just witnessed on your fake news. I really think so. You know, with Jade Helm going on in several states around the country and even several countries that are having their own Jade Helm, I think it's safe to say that this is the so-called ISIS attack in America now. Oh, I think it's true. It's very true. They are in our very own White House, and you will see more attacks like this one that's described in this story here, and it's all part of the coming changes from the several decades old agenda. And again, I say, remember, Texas is a Jade Helm state. So, you know, it's funny that I don't mean it's funny like haha, but it's kind of funny that this kind of thing is happening there. When, of course, they're doing exercises there as well. And there was a poll that was taking 63% think military should be used along our border. Oh, I think that's the best place for them, on our border, not other people's borders. An earthquake swarm shakes the East Bay cities. A string of moderate earthquakes has rattled the East Bay Sunday, shaking buildings. There were no immediate reports of injuries or damage. The U.S. Geological Survey says an earthquake with a magnitude 4.0, so that would make it maybe around a 6.0, because remember, they said, I got to remind people of this all the time, they set back the USGS scale a long time ago, several years ago, they set it back so from where it used to be. And I think the reason they did that is to hide some of the severity of these earthquakes that they call, oh, it's just a 2.5 or a 3.3. Add a couple on there. Anyways, that quake was later downgraded to a 3.6 by the USGS. It was centered a mile south of Concord along the Concord Fault. They continued getting these quakes. They had a 3.6, a 2.5, a 2.7, a 2.4, a 1.6. Some would say that's nothing, but if you're the one standing on the ground that's shaken, well, it's just every bit of something. The earthquake struck at a depth, they say, of 8 to 9 miles. And they say that deeper quakes are less noticeable, while a shallow one, within 0 to 40 miles depth, can feel much stronger. I remember the one we had here what, about a little over a year ago now. And they said it was a 4.4 at first, and then they moved it down, so it was a 3.8. No, it was every bit of a 4.4 or more, because we shook over here. Anyways, all this is linked up on latenightinthemidlands.com. Under news and discoveries, multiple UFOs filmed over the Philippines. They've got some video and some pictures. Very interesting stuff. You can go check out this article as well with the video on latenightinthemidlands.com under news and discovery. That's where you'll find all of our news all the time. Described as dancing lights. They say that it was filmed by several different witnesses in the province of Pampanga last Sunday night. And so this video is up. I watched it. Pretty interesting and absolutely strange. You know, it looked triangular. One of them looked triangular. Like, you get that light at the top of, like, the pyramid, and then the two at the bottom. And so it looked like another one of the notorious triangled shaped objects. Well, now they're checking out the Philippines. Okay. U.S. is in the longest hurricane drought in recorded history. Well, you know what that means. When they're telling you this, they want you to feel good about the several hurricanes that'll probably be coming this season. You know, in a stroke of luck, they say, no major hurricanes rated Category 3 or higher have struck U.S. soil during the past 9 years, a new study finds. They had to do a study on that. They couldn't just look at the record books. This is the country's longest hurricane drought. See, and we're paying for these studies, I bet you, too. This is the longest in this country's history for hurricane drought. They say the last one was 8 years, and it was from 1861 to 1868. And, you know, I've said it the last few years, and I'm not going to say it again this year. Even though now that they're putting out this kind of stuff, it kind of makes me think that, you know, this could be the year. But the last few years, I said that these storms were going to pick up. And, you know, they have. They just not been consistently enough of them. There's only been, you know, like the big one that hit the Philippines, what, I think, what, 233 or 34 mile an hour winds. Then you had, you know, so there's been, you know, a couple here or there, but they've not come, you know, one after the other yet. But I expect them to. The way we've screwed with the weather, I expect them to. And here's something else that scares me. I've not seen any chemtrails in our sky. I'd have to say in the last, the last 10 days, I've seen, I think, one chemtrail in the sky, just one. And I think it might have been an accident. Honestly, I mean, that's how it's been. And I'm telling you, ever since I've lived here, this sky has been painted with chemtrails. And in the last 10 days, I've not seen any. And that kind of concerns me. It's like, all right, so are they done? What are they done with? I don't think they're done, though. I don't know what the deal is. I'm telling you, they're all getting prepared for something. When, like I say, watch the animals. When you see them scat, something's coming. Like, you know, all of a sudden you see all the birds, which in this case would be the airplanes with the chemtrails. You see them leave the sky. You wonder what's coming. What do they know that we don't? Silicon Valley billionaires are trying to divide death. You know, those who have founded Google and Facebook, eBay, Napster, Netscape, PayPal even, using their billions of dollars to rewrite the nation's science agenda and transform biomedical research. They want to find ways to be able to alter the DNA, find ways to reprogram, they say, a patient's organs, limbs, cells, and DNA, so they can live longer and live better. Or is it so they can live longer and live better? So that's what they want to do. They want to figure out how to reprogram your DNA. Boy, this sounds like something. Boy, it sounds like some kind of ancient story I heard before. I don't know. It's on the tip of my tongue. I can't think of it. But boy, it sure sounds familiar. But that's what they want to do. They want to be able to start reprogramming. Now, see, this could be a good thing. I mean, don't get me wrong. You could add another 100 years on my life. I'd like it because that's 100 more years I get to do what I'm doing right now. But, you know, not at the expense of, because you got criminals who with this technology, that's who gets it. And they won't use it for good. And that's what concerns me. Now, last but not least, before I take the break, I want to touch on something that I touched on briefly last week. I'm gonna hit on this again because it's come to me again. I'm kind of a little disappointed. I really am. There are some people who I thought were wide spanking awake, and they are in some sense. But I see how easily they get fooled, and that concerns me. When I've got people who have been on my show, people who send me information and tell me, "Hey, this is it, man. I've got it figured out." And then they send me something like radio show host or attempted murder on radio show host Jeff Rentz and Stu Webb. Now, I don't know a whole lot about Jeff Rentz, so I'm not going to sit up here and bash him. Maybe whatever happened to him, I don't know. This is my opinion, though, or here's my advice. Can we see the police report? You know, I'm being told, oh, Stu Webb, too, they tried to run him off the road. No, nobody ran him off the road. Folks, stop falling for this horse crap. No one ran him off the road. You know what? I put up a story on the site, too. You can check it out. But briefly, I'll tell you. I've worked in the past with Glenn Kennedy. Brief run-ins with Stu Webb, who Glenn Kennedy insisted come on my show. Because, you know, criminals who flock together, you know, flock together. Gordon Duff never had the honor of hearing his BS personally live. But however, he has admitted that 40% of what he puts out there on Veterans Day, him and his writers, and I grant you now, Stu Webb was a writer of his. He was doing business over there. All right, so are some of these other guys. Now they're coming out against Gordon Duff, which, I mean, I don't mind seeing that because now they've just confirmed what I've told you in the past about Gordon Duff, right? But now, you see again, I hit one out of the park here, right? So now you got to look at these other two because I'm telling you the same thing about them. These guys, they're all together, all right? And here's the agenda. Now, Glenn's a marketer. He loves to market. So what Glenn's doing, he's giving Stu the marketing advice, and now Stu's telling everybody that they've got some ghost man, who if you donate $5,000 within 30 days, they've got a ghost man who's going to match that $5,000, and they're going to be able to do more for you. These are the same people who don't like homosexuals. These are the same people who don't like Muslims or anybody who's not Christian, thinks that you should all be dead and God should punish all of you. These are who they are. When I see people who Carrie Cassidy's another one. She's putting that stuff out there too. You know, when I see people who I thought were at least semi-awake, people who I at one time looked up to, and no, not Carrie. I'm talking about some others who I won't mention because I think they could have made mistakes, some of them. All right? But to promote these guys, has anybody asked for a police report? I'm not talking about a digital one. Remember Obama did that with his birth certificate. Remember that? Yeah, it's easy to fake. How about a real one? Can you get a copy and send it in the mail? Or can you give me the number to the police department that you dealt with so that I can call and ask them and confirm all this? Or did you not call the police? That's probably all right. Car gets run off the road, probably a busy area, right? And nobody's seen nothing. And of course, you know, you got a tow truck bill. Anything you can show me? Because until you do, I'm calling BS on this. All right? So I'm just getting that out there. Please, people, don't send me anything that has to do with known shills, known feds. I don't know who they work for at all. I'm not going to pretend I do, okay? But I'm going to tell you what, they're not working for you. They're not working for we the people. That I could guarantee you, and that I could defend in any courtroom in this country. I'm Michael Vera. This is Late Night in the Midlands on the LNM Radio Network. We're going to take a quick break here, and when we come back, we'll have my guest with us. She is psychic Jackie Barrett, and we'll be back, folks. Don't go anywhere. The L&M Radio Network offers a moderated chat room at www.latenightinthemidlands.com. Just click the chat and listen page from the drop-down menu at the top of any page on the website, or click the listen live button at the top of the homepage at www.latenightinthemidlands.com.
Hello, this is Dick Farrell here to tell you about OxySilver, legally available only through CureShop.com and HealthyWorldStore.com. Don't be fooled buying silver products from copycats and criminals. You've heard Dr. Leonard Horowitz and experts urge you to avoid deadly vaccinations and illegal operators selling stolen OxySilver and OxySilver copycats. You've heard experts tell you about suppression in alternative medicine and confusing propaganda in healthcare and the truth movement. Read Dr. Horowitz's book, Healing Celebrations, to learn how miracle healings can be made to happen through faith, prayer, and a pure diet. Get great immunity using vitamin C, D, and OxySilver, Liquid Dentist, GI Flora Pro, a top-shelf probiotic. Use Green Harvest as a great-tasting meal substitute for energizing organic nutrients and losing weight. And Zeola, and natural clays for detoxifying your body. More advice, all these products, and more are available from thecureshop.com. Including OxySilver, the world's most powerful silver hydrosol. Electro-energized to put risky injections, toxic antibiotics, and deadly drug pushers out of business. OxySilver is covalently bonded to water. Unlike any other silver product, using the frequency of chlorophyll 528, what Dr. Horowitz explains is pure tone love, the universal healer. NASA originally developed covalently body silver hydrosols to keep astronauts healthy in space. Dr. Horowitz added the 528 frequency to NASA's formula and more. OxySilver works three ways: to electrocute dangerous germs better than anything, far better than all leading silver products, and without any risk. OxySilver oxygenates and resonates with 528 for faster healing. So help save lives, putting drug lords and criminals out of business, and keep the LNM network broadcasting. Register for our free cooperative at healthworldaffiliates.com/4948. That's healthyworldaffiliates.com/4948. And buy OxySilver and other great products in package specials at great discounts from thecureshop.com. Buy OxySilver, GI Flora Pro, Green Harvest, Zeolove, and Love Minerals at great discounts at cureshop.com. That's cureshop.com with two P's. CureShoppe.com. Or call toll-free at 1-888-621-7611. That's 1-888-621-7611. Do it now.
The L&M Radio Network and Late Night in the Midlands depends on you, the listener. Without you, there would be no us. So help us continue to bring you the best guests with the best information, and subscribe today. Information on becoming an L&M subscriber can be found at the top of latenightinthemidlands.com. Just click the About Subscriptions tab and become part of the family while helping the truth stay alive. And while you're at it, maybe subscriptions aren't for you. A one-time donation helps as well. Click that donate button on the right side of latenightinthemidlands.com and help us help you. You want the truth? Late Night in the Midlands knows you deserve it. That's why we make it easy for you to listen at www.latenightinthemidlands.com. Go on over, become a member, be informed, and by all means, inform others. Folks, we're not your average radio show. We cover everything. Late Night in the Midlands on the LNM Radio Network.
The L&M Radio Network offers a moderated chat room at www.latenightinthemidlands.com. Just click the chat and listen page from the drop-down menu at the top of any page on the website, or click the listen live button at the top of the homepage at www.latenightinthemidlands.com.
middle of the night and there's nothing much to do. Bring your insomniac self over to Late Nights in Midlands and learn something. We've got every topic you can think of and very little being off limits. Alien abductions, government corruptions, the stuff that's got your sleep disrupted. Come join the conversation tales and tune in to Late Night in the Midlands with your host, Michael Vera.
Enough people send me this like it's some kind of big news thing. Oh my God, you know, and they're sending this stuff to me that I thought I should at least bring it up again. Stop sending it to me because I have to reframe from writing back to you and telling you off. I have to reframe myself from doing that, saying, well, no, wait a minute. Maybe they just don't know. Maybe they don't know. So I'm hoping if you're sending me stuff by email that you also listen to this show and that now you know. Okay, so now I got that off my chest. The website is www.latenightinthemidlands.com. You can also go to www.lnmradionetwork.com. That's another site that we have. My main site, of course, is latenightinthemidlands.com. And everything you need is there. The player, the chat room. There's also Ira's show. I mean, there's a lot of ways to listen to this whole network. And one way you can find out all those ways without me telling you all those ways is you can go over to latenightinthemidlands.com on the homepage. And you'll see below the picture slider, there should be a ways to listen, a little tab there. You click that, it falls open, and everything should be right there for you. If not, I'm sure I'll get emails telling me that it didn't work, but I'm not so sure. You might have to copy and paste the links. I don't think that they're linked up. Our website's going through some things, folks. There's going to be some changes made here soon. Again, I know, again, right? But for the better. We're always making changes for the better. With that, let me tell you a bit about my guest. I've been gone so long. I've only been on a couple nights, I think, the last week, that I got so much that I want to say, and most of it's just a bunch of ramble. And so I want to try to avoid doing that to you tonight. Jackie Barrett. For more than 26 years, Jackie has been a psychic, medium, and author. Her amazing abilities to both communicate with the dead and guide the living have propelled her into the spotlight. And I feel like talking about the other side tonight, too, so this is good. She is known throughout the world as America's foremost occult and paranormal expert. Jackie's remarkable efforts with the Red Cross and the Jackie Barnett Foundation have raised millions of dollars, and her compassion has earned her a great deal of respect, enabling her to help thousands of people from diverse backgrounds. She has clients from all over the world, and she will be talking to some of you tonight, maybe, if you call in, but don't call in right now. Wait. Well, we want to talk a few minutes here, and then we'll take calls, and I'm sure some of you may have questions, and you don't have to be afraid to call in. We don't bite here. We really don't. It just sounds that way sometimes. All right, so let's get Jackie on the line with us here. She's actually tried to call once, but I couldn't take it. So we will get her on with us now. We're ringing.
Hello.
Hi, Jackie. This is Michael Vera with Late Night in the Midlands. How are you?
I'm well, thank you. How are you, Michael?
I am doing fine, and I want to tell you we're live right now. So I welcome you to the show, and I've been looking forward to talking to you tonight.
Well, thank you very much. I'm honored.
Great. So, Jackie, I guess one good place to start is a little bit of background, and where did all of this start for you?
Let's see. probably as a child, growing up in a house of mediums and my father, who was a medicine man. So I have a very versatile background. And in that house of mediums was also a family of undertakers. So deep in a swamp in Louisiana. And I found out that I was able to not only see but communicate with the dead at a very young age, probably well before school age.
Wow.
And it snowballed.
So let me ask you this. When this first happened, I mean, what was it like? Was it, I mean, I can't imagine. I mean, especially at, say, 15 years old, you wake up one day and there's somebody talking with you that nobody else can see.
Yeah.
That'd be scary.
Well, it started very young, you know, probably maybe around 5 or 6 years old when I would dread to see the dead coming into the back of our house in Louisiana, which was the undertakers, the Palermo family. And I had this horrible fear of death at such a young age, and I would see them. I would see them roaming around the house at that age. But I also had a very good friend that some people would mistaken, like an invisible friend, a young mind that is occupied by a creative, let's just say. People think, you know, you know, they have this imaginary friend, but he sort of shielded me from many things, and I am now writing about that in my memoirs. So that will be in the forthcoming book, Mirror, Mirror in My Hand. So it's and I, you know, I came up with this title because we worked with mirrors as mediums, and I still do to this day, along with other tools, obviously. But
well, see,
yeah, I mean, it was scary. It was, you know, I would hide. I would hide in the house. I would hate the back door because that's where the dead would come through.
Did you tell mom and dad? And when you did, if you did, what did they think about it?
Well, my mother was a medium. My mother was a very well-known medium in Louisiana. Originated from Sicily, and I mean, this is something that has been in our bloodline for ages. I mean, my grandmother and her mother before her. So.
I wonder if it's like a lot of other things that people have. Because I have often wondered why some people have these gifts and others don't. And, there's a part of me that thought, well, everybody has the ability. They just don't know how. And I don't know if that's so true, though. I think that maybe it's in the DNA. Maybe it's written in the DNA.
Yeah, I sort of believe that. I think we all have this tug inside of us that maybe we shouldn't get on a train that day. Maybe something is stopping us. Maybe it is your guide. Maybe it's somebody in your family who has passed, or doesn't even have to be a relative. It can just be somebody who attached themselves to you, who actually enjoys being around you. I tend to believe that we all have a little bit of it, and then the rest, it's just an imprint from where you come from. And I come from a very highly spiritual background. I mean, you know, between the Vudan, which was the Palermo family, and my father's side, who were American Indians, and, you know, very, very spiritual, and had rituals going with that and so forth. So, you know, I'm coming from a background of very similar, I'd like to say, because it's like, you know, in both you're giving back.
Right.
But Mary had a little bit of a darker side to her, which was my mother. So there was, you know, a little battle of wits there, and I've worked for her since the age of 8 years old. I would conduct the seance in the house, which was the funeral home. So I was born into this.
I see.
So when she knew what I can do, it was a much sought after gift. So there was always something, you know, happening in our house. And, you know, I, like I said, I'm writing about my beloved friend growing up, who made things very lighthearted for me, along with my own dad, who sort of taught me the balance in life.
Mm-hmm. So,
but it didn't make it any easier being a very, you know, young child. And I deal with parents and children alike now with this, who right away they're assuming it's, you know, oh, it's an imaginary friend and it's occupying all their time.
Well, let me ask you this, and I'm not being funny at all. I'm wondering if this is how it works. But as a child, when you have friends on the other side, does that usually mean? I mean, is there like telltale signs of children who might just not want to say anything? I mean, do they have real friends too, or not to say that the ghosts aren't real friends, but you know, I mean, friends that everybody can see, I guess, is what I'm saying. So. So if you're mingling with those on the other side, I mean, is it hard to have other friends? I mean, because
absolutely it's hard. I mean, as I'm writing my memoirs now, you know, looking into my own mirror, and I'm actually, you know, doing it a bit different, where I'm interviewing the younger Jackie, and really taking a good look at both of us. And it was very difficult growing up and having friends when you're quote unquote the freak. So it was hard.
Yeah.
Sure, it's hard.
So out of all this now, I mean, some years have gone by and you've gotten, I'm sure, used to it and probably have gotten a lot better at your communicating with the other side. So
yeah.
Where, I mean, do you ever have conversations? Because I've had ghostly experience, but never once did I ever think of asking the questions that I really want the answers to, and that is, where are they? Where are they speaking to us from?
Well, you know, they're right next to us. And, you know, when people, I've had other mediums, I've listened to them, and I've heard them say that, you know, there's this heaven, and there is a place. There definitely is a place that these people go, but they're able to come and go. Excuse me. They're able to come and go and to communicate with us. Like, okay, my best example is, and I'm sure many of the listeners and has watched Pet Sematary.
Yeah.
So, you know, when the kid who gets killed and he's always leaning over the doctor's shoulder, telling him don't do this and don't do that, and you know, he's standing there, and as the audience we can see this, you know, but he couldn't, but he's hearing this voice in his head.
Yeah.
But as a medium, you know, a psychic medium, I'm able to see the full apparition, and when I don't see the full apparition, that worries me because I know demons never get it right.
Oh, so demons. Let's talk about demons for a moment. Now, I've asked that question several times with other guests, and there's a lot of them who don't want to really say that demons exist, except for to say that, well, there's just bad ghosts and good ghosts. I think there's a stage higher. I think there is what's called a demon. And I don't know
definitely.
If it's the biblical demon, as so to speak, but it's bad. And, you know.
It's very bad.
Yeah.
It's very, very bad. I've come head-to-head with some of the most profound exorcisms around the world. And my first journeys in life was to, as a missionary, to go and record these things, if they were real or not. And yes, some of them were psychosomatic, and yes, some of them were definitely, the person was invaded by this entity. And demons do exist. They do inhabit the human soul and spirit. Not all the time, you don't have to sit there and conjure this up. You just could be a very weak link, and it's like anything else. You're just vulnerable. It's like today, the pollen's blowing off my trees, so I'm prone to hay fever. So, you know, it's like anything else. You're more vulnerable to letting something in. And when it gets in, man, you have a hell of a time getting that out.
Now I've heard some pretty convincing stories about demonic entities. Bill Bean is a guy who's been a guest on this show several times, and he grew up in a house. And, I mean, I believe him. I mean, the guy's just, he could back up most of what he says, so I really believe him. And so now, where would these demons come from? Because obviously, I guess they've never had a body then. They've never been human. So what are they so angry about, and why? Where are they coming from? Are they like an extraterrestrial type thing? Because some people
say
that.
When I was dealing with the New York City Zodiac Killer and one-on-one and for quite some time, and that's when the book, The Haunting of the Gemini, had come out. Well, you know, he believes that it was something, the demon form that took over him. And, you know, people could say, well, he's looking to get out. No, he's not looking to get out. No, he doesn't care. No, he was looking to hand this over to me, and because he knew that I could spread the word, and most definitely that they do exist. And from what has happened to him as a young child before he became this, you know, notorious New York City Zodiac killer, he described as an extraterrestrial. So he's talking about aliens, and that's the demon form. Now, have I dealt with other quote-unquote possessed people that have described them as that? Yes and no. You know, I think it comes in different forms. I think there are different levels of demons, just like there are different levels of sainthood and good and everything like that. But most definitely, I mean, in my house alone, when I was dealing with Ronnie DeFeo from the Amityville Horror and the murders, and that's where The Devil I Know came out, that book from Berkeley as well, True Crime, there was a camera crew, somewhat atheist, you know, not all, I mean, I'm sure some of them had some sort of spirituality. I didn't have any communication with them aside from just saying, hello, how are you? And names weren't really even exchanged because there was so many of these folks roaming my house and setting up cameras and, you know, just all over the place. And they picked up things. They picked up full apparitions, doors slamming, doors opening, the fireplace going on and off, the refrigerator just opening by itself and things being tossed about. And there was a few, there was one producer who was with A&E who refused to ever step foot back into my home. There was quite a few things. So do these things exist? Yes. Yes, they do. The apparition that was seen in my house, one appeared to look like an older priest, very frightening though, and there was a levitation involved. Then there was something else that was very huge and menacing upstairs, and then there were other little things around. Needless to say, I still live in the same place, so, you know, we try to clear the place as much as we can, but
now, wait a minute, if you're a psychic medium, then it wouldn't matter if you cleared the place or not, right? You'd still be able to see these guys, wouldn't you?
Exactly, and they still, like, to this day, you know, I know sometimes the neighbors are like, oh my God, well, where are all these mattresses? Like, we're always throwing mattresses out and we always have to buy new ones. They literally, you know, within a few weeks, it looks like they were just broken in half. And this is just something that happens to us on a daily basis, you know. I hate to say anything because my mattress is like a month old now, and that's pretty old for us. But things happen all the time. I mean, when, you know, we say goodnight, sometimes the alarm goes off, there's no one there, the police have to come, they check everything out, there's nothing there, TV goes on and off, we had that checked, and I know the guys listening tonight, from Hot Concepts, the fireplace people, best in the business come and redo the fireplace 6 times in one season.
Nothing was happening.
They were like, Jackie, nothing's happening, it's fine. And finally, you know, it just blew out, and it's gas. So, you know, it's in a glass case as well, and it has marble around it, and there's a large gate in front of it. So there was no wind coming through, no nothing, and it blew out, and he's standing there, and I'm standing there, and I was so frustrated, and I just screamed. I said, come back on now. And it just poof, it came on, and he was like, I don't know what the hell is going on.
See,
I don't know.
I lived in a place.
We had it fixed. We make it look nice, but we choose not to turn it on.
I lived in a place that had activity, and I'd often debated whether these entities were somewhat demonic because of the things that they tried to do. But
like I felt like I've been literally pushed into the bed. My husband, who's a pretty big guy, you know, he has been attacked numerous times. And you get this feeling like, you know, my bathroom is all glass doors. So it's like when you're in the shower, it's like you got to get the soap out of your eyes really fast because you know something's standing there. So I mean, this happens, and then I could just see it like really fast go by. But I've also seen, you know, things come in the form of animals. And, you know, people always say, oh, animals are so, you know, I'm a huge animal lover. I'm an animal activist. And when, you know, some of the things that I have seen, it would look like a cat. And it's missing some of its limbs, or the head isn't on right. And demons just don't get it right. You know, they just don't get the form properly. Or maybe, just maybe, they want to let us know, you know, we're coming to you in a form of something. To me, the most angelic are animals and children. So, but yet you're wrong. You know, it's just all wrong. And then, you know, the bad smell follows, and the lights will start flickering.
The ones that scare me, and I've seen these true stories are supposed to be of these demonic type entities, and the ones that would scare probably the life right out of me are the Undertaker ones. There's one, you know, this Undertaker looking guy who appears at the end of your bed, and you wake up and he's standing
over
you.
Well, actually, that's the guy, you know, like, I was out filming a show for A&E, and it was with the captain of police, because I work with now retired Sean Crowley.
A&E, that's funny you say that, because they're going to be sending some cameras here to cover my story middle of next month, I think. So
it is so crazy. But when we were out doing medium PI, you know, I came home and I was like, what happened? What happened in the house? And things were turned upside down and what have you. And my husband didn't tell me until later on, because he knew I was under a lot of stress, because, you know, when you're dealing on homicides, this is, you know, someone's life. And obviously the word homicide says it all. And, you know, it's the families that are left behind with all the unanswered questions and the suffering. And, you know, I'm there trying to do whatever I can for them. And, you know, I want to say to bring some sort of peace, but, you know, is there ever truly a peace in homicides? So, in any event, he described, William, my husband, described this thing in our house as an undertaker. Like I don't watch wrestling, and he said it literally looked like the Undertaker from the this wrestler.
Oh, he did.
And he was standing upstairs in the house across from the fireplace, and William was downstairs on a computer. And at that time, our little dog, Max, he was about 20, and he came running up the steps, and he thought he heard something, and he saw him standing there, and his first, you know, thought was somebody broke in, and his face was sort of downward, and then he just disappeared.
Wow.
So... yeah, we have, you know, we have things, and, you know, there are many times, and I know, like, a lot of my clients are listening, and there are many times where we're in my office, in my home, and right across from the garage, it sounds like somebody's in there emptying out boxes. But that didn't happen until I dealt with Ronnie DeFeo. And at that time, the public didn't know about it. I was a year and a half into dealing with him every day. And there would be banging around in the garage, boxes being tipped over as though somebody was looking for something.
And this
but then there were other things that were, you know, very, very... touching and very sweet, and you know, from children who had passed, and the parents would send me their belongings for helping on their cases of homicide, and it was, I would treasure these things, and I would have them on display, and I would find the items moved around.
Yeah.
Or I would watch my now puppy, my little two-year-old Maltese Violet, playing with someone. And I would get a glimpse of her. And lo and behold, this was like one of the wildest, most beautiful things. I kept going back and forth to the dentist in the city, and they couldn't find anything wrong. And I kept having pain and pain and pain. And I would travel, you know, a good hour and a half there and back. And right down the block, there was a dentist. And I would often look at this place and just, you know, get on the iron horse and, you know, just chug a lug it to the city, right into the heart of Manhattan. And I saw this beautiful girl waving me on, and I went over to the office, and I went up to the steps, and she told me that he would help me, and I was in horrible pain. I had an earache every day, and my jaw was hurting, and they couldn't find anything. So I make an appointment, and I get to see him, Dr. Frank Lombardo. And I grew to love, love, love this man. And I said, you know, this girl referred me. You know when they say, who referred you?
Yeah.
Well, I didn't have a name, but I had a description. And it was his daughter who had made the transition onto the other side. As they say, the other side is, instead of saying death. So, well, I was taken back by this, like, so much that he said, was it her? And he showed me a picture of her. And I said, yes. She told me you would help me. And I found out it was his daughter. So, anyway, he did find out what it was within 5 minutes, and it was such a bad infection, and that he had to do a root canal and what have you. And in the middle of doing all this stuff, the lights would flicker, the machinery would go down, I mean, that's very common with me.
That might have been the ghost telling you don't get the root canal.
No, she. Thank goodness she did, because I was my eardrum was getting perforated from it. So thank goodness she did help me, and she comes to visit, and she's just the most angelic thing I have ever seen. She plays with Violet, and I've seen her in the house, and it feels so good, and her smile is so warm, and she would come and go now and then, but there are others also. You know, there's another girl, a teenager, Ashley Love, who was murdered, and I have her sweatshirt, and I know her mom is listening, and she comes to visit often, and I've seen her sitting in my room and just watching me. So, you know, these are people, you know, who are on a higher plane than us. I mean, we don't understand everything, but they do.
Yeah, once they cross over, they
see the truth, they know everything. They forgive. Forgiveness, you know, I practice forgiveness. I think it's very important to forgive. And, you know, make no mistakes, it doesn't mean to be a doormat. It means to let go of the baggage that is tormenting you.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that's, you know, that's another facet of my my many hats that I wear, is to teach that.
Well, you know, I let go of mine every night I come on the air. I let it roll off, and then we go on to something much more pleasant. Like, well, not to see now, homicides, sir. That's a creepy kind of
yes.
Of
it's very dealing. Difficult. It's very difficult. Yeah. The first one I describe in the book, The Devil I Know, and it's somewhat of my life story going back and forth with Ronnie DeFeo's. And how our lives paralleled, because my mother had passed during an exorcism, and I had gotten there.
She passed during an exorcism?
Exactly. Oh, and I had gotten there somewhat too late when I was called into it, and I had to fly in, and everything that could possibly stand in my way was standing in my way. And it was... it's something that I have to live with, and I try to make better at each person that I deal with. So it's, you know, I've had this darkness in my life, and I try to compensate and maybe overcompensate with the goodness in people and finding the goodness in humanity.
Well, God bless you. You know, I try to do that too, and there's a lot of it. There really is. There is a lot of it, but I'll tell you, there's the yin and the yang. They're well balanced.
It's difficult, yes.
Yeah.
It is a difficult task. It's, you know, it's letting go. And most of it is letting go of the fear of saying, but what about me? But what about me? You know, I get that all the time. It's, you know, I can't forgive this one. I can't forgive him or her for hurting me because of their actions. And you're never going to get to fully enjoy life if you don't let it go. And life is very short. Life as we know it is very short.
Yeah. Oh, it sure is. It seemed like yesterday, you know, I was getting up watching cartoons on Saturday morning. And those days have far been gone. But Jackie,
I know that.
We've got to take a break here, so let's do that, and then we'll come back. I've got a question or two from the chat room I'd like to present to you, and of course we'll open lines too after the break. Let me ask you this, Jackie. If somebody was to call in, you're able to give them a short kind of phone reading?
I don't think we're going to do phone readings, but I can direct them. I'll do the best I can in directing them to a definitive answer.
Okay, well, that's fair enough. All right, so Jackie, and the last name, is it Barrett or Barrett?
Well, it would be Barrett if I still lived on the Bayou, but since I'm in Brooklyn, New York, it's Barrett.
Okay, great. So Jackie Barrett is my guest, folks. She's a psychic medium. You're welcome to call in with your questions after the break. The call-in number, 803-317-2264. You're listening to Late Night in the Midlands on the LNM Radio Network. We'll be right back. LNM Radio has joined with the Hardened Structures team to provide state-of-the-art survival shelter design and build services at LNM Radio exclusive rates. Hardened Structures, with over 21 years experience in military, commercial, and private shelter design build services, are also offering LNM Radio listeners a free consultation, normally a $500 value. So click on the Hardened Structures banner on the right-hand side of Late Night in the Midlands to receive your special offer today. Looking to advertise to a large worldwide audience, but at an affordable price? Contact the station at mv@latenightinthemidlands.com and tell us what you're looking for, and we can make it happen. That's mv@latenightinthemidlands.com. The LNM Radio Network offers a moderated chat room at www.latenightinthemidlands.com. Just click the chat and listen page from the drop-down menu at the top of any page on the website, or click the listen live button at the top of the homepage at www.latenightinthemidlands.com.
Hello, this is Lisa Marie, here to tell you about OxySilver, legally available only through CureShop.com and HealthyWorldStore.com. Don't be fooled buying silver products from copycats and criminals. You've heard Dr. Leonard Horowitz and experts urge you to avoid deadly vaccinations and illegal operators selling stolen OxySilver and OxySilver copycats. You've heard experts tell you about suppression in alternative medicine and confusing propaganda in healthcare and the truth movement. More advice, all these products and more are available from CureShop.com, including OxySilver, the world's most powerful silver hydrosol, electro-energized to put risky injections, toxic antibiotics, and deadly drug pushers out of business. OxySilver is covalently bonded to water, unlike any other silver product, using the frequency of chlorophyll 528, what Dr. Horowitz explains is pure tone love, the universal healer. NASA originally developed covalently bonded silver hydrosols to keep astronauts healthy in space. Dr. Horowitz added the 528 frequency to NASA's formula and more. OxySilver works three ways to electrocute dangerous germs better than anything, far better than all leading silver products, and without any risks. OxySilver oxygenates and resonates with 528 for faster healing. So help save lives. lives, putting drug lords and criminals out of business, and keep the LNM network broadcasting. Register for our free cooperative at healthyworldaffiliates.com/4948. That's healthyworldaffiliates.com/4948. And buy Oxy Silver and other great products in package specials at great discounts from thecureshop.com. Buy Oxy Silver, GI Flora Pro, 528 Superfood, Zeo Love, and Love Minerals at great discounts at cureshop.com. That's cureshop.com with two P's. Cure Shop. Or call toll free at 1-888-621-7611. That's 1-888-621-7611. Do it now.
Looking to advertise to a large worldwide audience, but at an affordable price? Contact the station at mv@latenightinthemidlands.com and tell us what you're looking for, and we can make it happen. That's mv@latenightinthemidlands.com.
Many cases is the idea that the aliens are essentially trying to create a hybrid mix of themselves and ourselves. They're interested in our DNA, our genetic makeup. Bodies. And beyond that, they're interested in our personalities, our affection for our children, our love for one another, a whole kind of range of what we think of almost the most human characteristics we have emotionally.
We have to face up to reality that, for example, the UFO phenomenon is a real phenomenon, no question about it. So anybody who debunks the UFO phenomenon itself don't know what he or she's talking about.
Hey, Michael, I promised you I'd call in for a little bit, and here I am.
I know that I bashed Bush the entire time. I wasn't even allowed on Coast to Coast there for a while because I was told not to talk about Bush.
In the councils of government, we must guard against the acquisition of unwarranted influence, whether sought or unsought, by the military-industrial complex.
If you're listening to this, you are the resistance.
Late Night in the Midlands. We cover everything. And it really says, with the way the weather's been here, it has been fantastic. It's almost like a Rochester, New York kind of summer here it's been. So it's been really nice, and we've had great company as well with Donna and Bruce, and so we're having a good time. But, folks, the call-in number is 803-317-2264. I also want to give a shout-out to our radio affiliates, the Dark Matter Radio Network. Hello to all of you. And K98 Talk. Hello to all of you. And, of course, High Point Radio, the top of New Jersey. They cover New York, New Jersey, and Pennsylvania on 100.5 FM and 1700 AM. So we salute you all. And, of course, everybody who listens on LateNightInTheMidlands.com or the L&M Radio Network, for that matter. So let's get back to it, folks, with my guest, Jackie Barrett. And Jackie, seances. I noticed that on your website I seen something about seances. Tell me a little bit about those.
Well, it's a form of communication. It's a very old form of communication. And how I go about it is actually how I do readings. I let the dead speak through me and to the person who needs the communication, let you see them within the eyes, every sense in the form of the word. It's only people who have been exposed to myself during this ritual knows what it's truly like to have a one-on-one with someone you lost and you love.
Been there.
Yes, exactly.
But, you know, I wonder if, like, here, you know, it's, oh my God, she or he died, and we're so sad, and of course we're sad because we're sad that we're going to miss them is what really gets us. It's kind of a selfish thing that we go through. But I wonder if that on the other side, if for on that side, it's like, oh, wow, new baby boy or new baby girl. Or, you know, if you're actually being born somewhere else when you're dying here.
I think you have the, you know, the opportunity to come back around when you wish to. There are people who don't want to leave and want to stay with their loved ones. And, you know, we not only miss them, but they in turn miss us. And that's why they watch over us. That's why they stay around.
I see.
They guide us. They try to comfort us. But many, many times the grief is just so unbearable that we can't look at the subtle signs that they are giving. They'll come to us also when we're sleeping. You know, that's your most, supposedly to be your most restful place. You know, your mind is open. I myself find it very hard to sleep because I have been astro traveling most of my life. And that's how I am able to even communicate with people that are living through this form of what we would call technology.
Yeah. Yeah, well, you know, it's a big mystery, but I guess for some, like for myself, I know there's something else. I can't even begin to say exactly what it's about. All I can say is that the visitation I had, you know, she seemed pretty happy. And she told me that God was real. And so, well, for that, I'd have to say it's not a demon, because I had some heavily religious folks who were trying to convince me that if that happens and you see somebody from the other side, that it's got to be a demon. And I say no, because demons aren't coming and telling you that there's a God and smiling when they say it.
So. No, that's not true. That's not true at all. That's not true at all. There are heavenly beings that visit us. There are people that have passed that visit us, and demons don't come near them. They're actually protected from that. Children are protected. You know, there's there's a whole separate area, and how I described it from what I have seen. And I myself had died during a ruptured appendicitis, and I have seen what was on the other side when I was very, very small. And I can tell you that it's the most glorious place, and there are people to take care of these little ones and family members, and they can come and go. They can definitely come and go. It's not just demons. If they were that religious, they wouldn't believe that the only entity that could come around the living would be something evil. Why not something good?
Or both.
You know, and then if you're that religious, Jesus Christ himself is in the spirit. In the spirit. You know, so...
Yeah.
What would that be?
Well, you know, and they'll bounce with you all day on that. And it's just, you know, there's some things I just... it makes me slap my head, and I wonder how people at this day of age can... you know, think that, you know, for me, somebody with psychic abilities, I see it as a gift. I don't know how you yourself see it, but I see it as a gift. Some people would probably rather not have that gift. Some people, I guess, right, accept it. But you know, I don't see it as some curse or demonic thing. And
it's not demonic. No. There's the evil is feeling other people's pain. It's hurtful. It's sometimes it's unfair. You know, like, why can't, I mean, I grew up saying, why can't I just be like the others, when, you know, I was told we are the others. So it's, you know, you have a, you know, double-sided sword there. You can't, you know, you can't fully comprehend, you know, the living without knowing the dead, and vice versa. So I tend to stay away from people like that. I'm not into any one particular religion. I think spirituality covers more of a humanitarian base. And as for myself, I was a missionary for 23 years, or actually more than that. But I've seen my share of heartaches. I've seen my share of starving children. I've seen my share of exorcisms, and you know, and good. And I believe in the human spirit. I believe that what you are in life, you are in death.
Oh, then there could be some really rotten people on the other side, then.
I'm sure, but I do not believe that they're hanging with the good. They're not allowed. It's like, no way. You're not coming on this side. And they're protected. And, you know, from the American Indian standpoint, I'm a huge believer in totems. And, you know, I myself... we're given them at birth, and mine was the wolf, and, you know, my daughter's is the bear, and so we're forced, and we believe in that, in the good, and the innocent shall stay the innocent and be protected. You know, if you're rotten, and in life, you know, you're not going to share the glory. You know, I don't believe that. And well, I've been in maximum security prison, and I've been on death row, and I've interviewed, you know, 10,000 plus hours for each person, and have these recordings myself. And I could tell you that most of them do not regret what they have done. Just feel that they're being punished for no good reason. And these people there's a place for them. Trust me. There's a place for them.
I see. Yeah, you know, and I think that we all come here for a lesson, and I think that even some of those lessons aren't, you know, maybe that's something we've got to take with us to the ultimate goal, whatever that might be. Maybe sometimes we'll have to come back and experience what it's like to be, like, I don't know, like, say I'm rotten to somebody in this lifetime, and I torture them, and I'm just horrible, and eventually kill them. Maybe I come back, and now I have to be in the wear the other shoes, so that I could.
Maybe, or maybe you'll meet your match, and you know you'll have company with people just like yourself, and you'll be stuck in some kind of prism. And you'll just be chasing each other around. Who has the biggest cleaver, you know? So, you know, it's sort of like that. I've had ghosts argue, and I know they were ghosts arguing in my house.
Oh, wow. Ghosts arguing in the house.
I say it was this, you know, it was two guys that just kept going at it and arguing, but... When others would walk into the room, they would hear them whispering, and it's so strange because they knew I could see them, and I've only heard it once. It was, here she comes, here she comes. Mm-hmm. You know, so, I mean, it scared me. You know, you don't always, even though I see them and I hear them and I feel them, I could feel... You know, someone sit on my bed at night, or the blankets being pulled, or...
Oh, boy.
You know, but, look, I have to get a good night's sleep, you know. I at least try to. So we incorporate a lot of humor into things. I believe you have to have that.
Yeah.
And you have to get crazies out, too, you know, so...
Yeah, well, yeah, absolutely. And, yeah. You know, so... I don't know, and I guess I looked at life a lot different, you know, when I was younger than I do now. And, you know, when I was younger, I used to think, why do we have to die, blah, blah, blah. And, you know, and it was horrible to think about. And now, you know, I still don't want to, you know, go through it, but we're all going to have to. And you know, but I know that there is something. And that's reassuring for me. And it's not, and me, I'm not a biblical person. I'm not a religious type person, so
right.
I'm not going off those standards to say there's something. I'm going by experience. I have experienced it. I know I haven't lost
right.
my mind. So, you know, I know what happened was real. And, you know, I just, you know, but I dealt with some bad ones too. And I just hope that
yeah.
when I go to the other side, I don't have to deal with them. Because
I truly believe the good outweighs the bad. And I think everybody who has been touched in otherworldly way, as such as yourself and myself, where as a child I obsessed over, oh my God, you know, I saw a young girl come in through the back door, which means the funeral home, and, you know, will I be next? Will I be next? And then as, you know, that was like 8 or 9 years old. And then as you get older, you know, you learn not to obsess, but to live in the moment. And it's very important to live, and that's another thing I teach, to live in the moment of life, because then you're not living.
And Jackie,
you're just waiting. Well, you're just waiting to die.
One of our listeners asked if you could elaborate a little bit on what you did as a missionary. And I will ask you all in the chat, if you have a question for our guest or for me, please PM those questions. PM. This way, otherwise I'll lose them in the chat, and I'm not going to go fishing through the chatter to find them. So you got to PM me. But that's a question from our chat room.
Well, missionary work was to, you know, do the work of God. And was that a religious standpoint at that time? Yes, it was. I traveled different parts of the world helping others in need. And then, as I got into my late teens, 18, 19 years old and 20, it changed over when I was confronted in Kenya by a boy who was taken over by a demon.
In Kenya, you said?
And that's when everything changed for me. I found myself sitting at the foot of the bed, recording the whole event. And it's sort of like, you know, you have this new label now. You have this new title. And someone has to always record what is going on. So it was your missionary work as a humanitarian, and this work as finding, is it a true possession, or is it something else?
Right.
You know, and I have seen other things. I have witnessed people being bitten in front of me, and huge bite marks, and, you know, and actually, you know, there is someone who I'm working with now, where the hospital themselves have, you know, they saw this. So as far as the missionary work went, as helping, feeding people, showing them how to, and I'm not a farmer, and I was thrown into farming. And then it took a turn for a more spiritual, let's just say, place. And I guess, you know, it kept pulling me back that way and pulling me back, maybe because something that I was supposed to do, what I am doing now.
I see. We've got another question from the chat, Jackie. And David asks about communications with the Greys at the deep underground military base near Deuce, New Mexico. I guess I'll try to simplify this. Disguising themselves as dead ones. Okay, so what he wants to know is, have you had communication with Greys or any alien? And if so, are they disguising themselves as dead people?
Okay, I did have communication, and, you know, I'm not sure what quite happened to me. I know I lost some time, and that I never regained. I didn't see them as dead people. I saw them as the living, but as they touched me, I felt my body. The only way I can describe it is if you're laying flat and your body feels like clay and it's being molded and your bones are being broken. I remember trying to get up afterwards and go into my father's room, and, you know, we grew up in a really strict household. There was no night lights. There was no this, there was no that. There was no, you fear nothing. But yet, there was everything in that house that you would be afraid of. And as I stood, I literally felt my legs go out from under me, and I just remember screaming that all my bones were broken.
Wow.
And I felt these hands, and I saw these faces, and every one of them had blue eyes. Every one of them had very, 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 very pale skin, very, very pale skin. And I don't remember seeing the hair. That I don't. I don't remember seeing that. But their features looked as of a human, and their hands felt like human. There was nothing sexual about it. It was more of a forming, like if you were bending and forming and molding something. Now, I spoke to a priest that I know, who the movie was made of, The Rite, Father Jeffrey Grob, and I've spoken to him several times, and he was frightened by that because he thought it was something trying to get in to invade this person, myself, who was set forth to help people overcome many, many different difficulties in life, and also the rite of the exorcism. So I wasn't sorry about that. So I wasn't sure what actually happened to me.
I see. All right. And we have yet another question. Tomato Picker. He asks, Michael, has she ever seen a possessed person take on a demonic persona, i.e. devil in the flesh?
Have I ever seen a possessed person take on
a devil persona? A demonic persona. So basically a devil in flesh. Like, I guess somebody...
Yeah, okay. Yes, absolutely.
And what was that? What was that like? I mean, is it a possession?
It's a possession. I have come across something that I do believe I met Lucifer. Yes, and it was a human that changed into something else.
Ooh, a shapeshifter, maybe.
Yes. And being American Indian, we know how to shapeshift ourselves. And that's one thing I've learned probably about 10 years old.
Sorry about that.
Probably about 10 years old.
Hello? Oh, okay. Well, we've lost... Hold on, let me get our guest back on here. We lost her. Folks, when you call in, you've got to have your volume turned down on your end. Because if not, then I have to get rid of you. And so that's what I had just done. And I really can't take a call right this second because I have to get my guest back on the line here. So everybody hang out with us and... All right, well, you know, this is a good time. Yeah, we lost her, so we'll have to get her back on. So everybody, hang on for a moment. This is Late Night in the Midlands on the LNM Radio Network, and we'll be back in just a couple minutes.
LNM Radio has joined with the Hardened Structures team to provide state-of-the-art survival shelter design and build services at LNM Radio exclusive rates. Hardened Structures, with over 21 years experience in military, commercial, and private shelter design build services, are also offering LNM Radio listeners a free consultation, normally a $500 value. So click on the Hardened Structures banner on the homepage or the chat and listen page and have peace of mind that no matter what happens, your family is protected. Talk to you soon. Thank you.
The LNM Radio Network offers a moderated chat room at www.latenightinthemidlands.com. Just click the chat and listen page from the drop-down menu at the top of any page on the website, or click the listen live button at the top of the homepage at www.latenightinthemidlands.com.
It's the middle of the night and there's nothing much to do. Bring your insomniac self over to Late Nights and Midlands and learn something. We've got every topic you can think of, and very little being off limits. Alien abductions, government corruptions, the stuff that's got your sleep disrupted. Come join the conversation, tales, and tune in to Late Night in the Midlands with your host, Michael Vera.
That's good news. I don't know what happened. We lost.
I don't know.
I went to mute somebody else because, folks, when you call in, you've got to keep quiet on your end. If I hear any interference at all, I'm immediately will get rid of you. I've got your number here, and I won't answer for you again. So keep it real when you call, or you know you're not going to get through no more. So with that, we're back. We've got about another, 15 minutes to go here before we're done tonight. And we've got a couple more questions here from the chat that I'd like to try to get to. And, of course, then I want to give you the floor to get out anything that you'd like to get out. Another listener asks, does she know about the 300,000 children a year being taken by the Greys? I don't know. Do you know anything about that? I don't think you're being spotlighted here like a suspect or anything, but asking about the Greys.
I'm sorry I don't. And the reason why I'm going to take the fifth on this is that, you know, children are being abducted all the time, so we don't want to just blame one organization, let's just say.
Yeah.
You know, I've worked on homicide enough for 23 years plus that, and I've been hired out by, New York City court system and DAs to work with Sean Crowley enough to know that there is a black market out there and trade for children. So I don't want to say, yes, children have all gone to this. I'm sure and I know that it has happened. I know of a few cases that are very, very quiet that are being handled in West Virginia by the FBI, but I also know that with all the social media that we have and children have access to this, leaves us open for an enormous amount of kidnappings.
And Jackie, I love your answer that, you know, you didn't want to just put it in one category like, okay, it's the Greys doing it all, because that's very, very responsible of you, because there are organizations around the country, around the world, that have these child trafficking networks going, so it's not always ET. You know, you can't
absolutely. I was appalled at I'm working on a case now, and I had to assume a different identity on Craigslist, and I was appalled to see how many men posted themselves up there without their drawers on. I mean, this was completely sickening. I was like, oh, my God, this is like really Craigslist? Like, give me a break.
Oh, I know. You know, it is one of the
It's like, you know, penis facile. Come on.
It's the
really?
It's the Bates Motel of the internet.
Exactly. Exactly. It's just social media. This is why we have lack of communication. People don't want to speak of the ones that we've lost, but yet you'll talk to a computer and you'll just assume for guys, you think there's this beautiful, sexy girl behind this computer luring you in, or girl on girl, you know, acting cutesy, and guy on guy, and come on, baby. And it can just be someone's grandma doing it, or some really low life, like, you know, greasy car salesman type of guy.
And you think it's
like this 15-year-old boy who is the same age as you. I mean, we have become the nation of non-communicable people where we don't even know how to speak to each other in a grocery store. The word excuse me, please, and thank you has left the English language.
Oh, it sure has. You're not kidding. And, you know, call me old-fashioned, if you will, but, you know, it still exists in my world, in my house.
Me too. I am, and you know, if there is somebody with, you know, a baby carriage, an elderly person, you can go before me. You know, you can go before me, and I will take the walk with you back home if you need be. I don't get it. We, like I said, we have become a type of nation where we run home from our, you know, slave 9-to-5, and we sit in front of a computer to speak to another person. I never got that language. Like, how do you speak by typing? And how is capital letters yelling? Like, I just don't understand the, you know, what we've turned into.
Well, it's a
whole
new...
And we expect as mediums, and I believe, you know, just by talking to you, I believe you are on a certain level. You're able to communicate. That's why they're communicating with you so much. And you're able to speak with people all the time. And mediums, we can. There isn't anything I wouldn't speak about. I've gone on dates with people to teach them how to act. I've raised the dead for them. I've helped them get from teacher's license to truck driver's license. I've helped chase down the bad guy. I've recorded exorcisms. I've partaked in them. I don't get how we can say there is no good, there is no angelic, there are no angels, there are no friendly spirits, only bad, when we can't even speak to the living. How can you expect anyone to speak to the dead if they can't speak to the living?
Yeah, that's true. That's very true. Communication is important for me. You know, I love talking to people, even off the show, you know. But, it depends. There's some people you could just tell they're never going to get it. And you don't even want to waste your time with those people. I don't.
Right. And they're on a different level. They're just on a different level. And that's when you have to, you know, smile, walk away, and just be thankful that, you know, you have more than one brain cell, you know, and laugh it off. I mean, that's what I do. When I shut my door, I shut my door. Like, there's no ifs, ands, or buts, you know.
Absolutely.
There's a line in life. So, just as you won't cross it, you don't expect anyone else to cross it. But people have lost contact with each other, and I really feel bad for that. Most of all, I feel bad for that. I feel bad that we lose people in our families without reconnecting or, you know, just making amends and learning how to forgive and bury your old baggage, and that's why Will and I got married in the cemetery, not because we're old goths or anything. It's very traditional in Louisiana to bury your past and to move on with the future. So, you know, and actually we just did it over, so it was really something.
Well, Jackie, what I'd like to do is I would like to give you the floor, and I enjoyed talking with you tonight. I'd like to bring you back at a later date and get you on for a full show one night if you're interested. And what I'd like to do now is give you the floor to get out anything that you'd like, and we'll keep you linked up on our website at latenightinthemidlands.com. And I thank you so much for being with us.
Oh, thank you. Well, first I'd like to thank my wonderful husband for putting up with me all these years, and me putting up with him. I just want to say I love you, Dr. Frank, and Linda, his daughter, and of course my daughter. But we have some exciting news that, of course, you know, many of the people know, The Devil I Know, along with The Haunting of the Gemini, has been bought by Universal Studios, and it's in a development stage of a scripted television drama with Noriken Productions. That's the executive producer, Jennifer Lopez, Elaine Goldsmith, Thomas and Jude Wang, with the film rights. They have the film rights to both of my books, and I'm looking forward to getting this one out and on the shelf, Mirror Mirror. And I just want to thank my family for always standing by me and beside me.
Okay. Well, I thank
you. And thank you for giving me this opportunity to hopefully reach somebody who needs to, and I stress this in the world we live in, practice forgiveness.
Well, I couldn't agree with you more on that. Absolutely. At least to an extent where you can move on. I mean, we're not asking you to forget. Just forget.
Exactly. We never forget, you know. I like interviewing the younger Jackie to write this book. I decided to do that, and I separate myself from her because I praise her as this entity that grew hard and not a great household. And it was a very difficult book to write because you cross the line and hurting anyone. It's been a journey, and, you know, I'm grateful for life. I love life, and I just I hope I could spread the word long enough to help others heal from abusive childhoods and coming out of it from the other side. And you know, it's growing up as a medium is just as hard as children coming out with different sexualities and being judged, you know, is very difficult. And I've come face to face with people where I had to be very careful at that split second. They were thinking of taking their lives because of their peers wouldn't accept them, or you know, the world wasn't traced out for different types of folks, and indeed it is. And you know, first we have to love, forgive, and let go in order to live.
That's right. Well, Jackie, again, thank you so much, and shoot me an email down the line here in the next few weeks, and we could plan another show and have you on for a full show. And again, thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, and have a wonderful, wonderful evening.
All right, you too. And, oh, the website? I've got it linked up, but for those who are not at my website, you want to give it out so folks can Get over
yes,
to
it's the house that Kay built, and it's that website was actually made after a book that I had written. That gives you a little bit of a glimpse. People thought it was, you know, they were like, "Oh, that stuff is fake," until it came on TV. But in any event, you know, I'd like to thank everybody, and I hope you, you know, grab a copy of that book, "The Devil I Know: The Haunting of the Gemini," and get a deeper look inside who Jackie Barrett really is.
All right. Well, Jackie, again, thank you very much, and we'll be in touch. Have a great night.
Well, thank you. Have a great night. Bye.
All right. You too. Bye-bye. All right, everybody. There you have it. Jackie is linked up on the homepage of LateNightInTheMidlands.com, so go check it out. It'll be there until the wee hours of the morning, and then it'll move to our links page. Folks, I'm cutting out an hour early tonight because Adonna and Bruce are leaving in the morning, and they're out there now, and I want to go spend at least a good 30 minutes with them before they take off. And folks, I thank you all so much for being patient with us throughout the last week. Ivor's done a great job of filling in for me. And folks, I'll be back with you tomorrow night with Dr. Turi. We will take calls tomorrow, and I'm trying to keep them on as long as I can tomorrow. And I want as many calls as you can give me. Let's load them up. So folks, that's tomorrow night. Keep your eyes posted to the sky, because you never know what you might see. Keep your ears posted to this broadcast, because you never know what you might learn. Good night, everybody.